It will be a formal lecture on interpretation of coronary angiogram by Dr. Goyal. Dr. Goyal, are you logged in?
Yeah, he's already there, sir. Good afternoon, sir. Morning, Dr. Goyal. He's there, logged in.
Okay. Request Dr. Goyal to present his data on interpretation of coronary angiogram. Dr. Goyal?
Sir, one minute I'll take before Dr. Goyal sir starts presenting. We were trained by him. He's so passionate about interpreting angiograms, right? Even before the intracoronary imaging and all that. Lot of things we have learned from him. And he used to play with the Tagarno machine which he used to have before. Taught us a lot of things. And as he follows that, again, angiogram interpretation. Sure. I think over to you, Dr.
Goyal. See, so there is enough time probably so I can speak.
No. You have 1 hour, sir. You have one hour.
Okay. 1 hour. Because this is something, you know, I might, whatever, let us see. So you asked me to speak on interpreting coronary angiograms.
Angiograms.
So you can see my, can you see my presentation? No.
No, you can't see. You have to share the screen.
How do I share the screen?
Click on the share screen button bottom. Hmm? Below the green button below the bottom. Click on the share screen.
Just a sec. Sorry. Share screen.
Yeah, click on that. You have opened your presentation already, sir. You need to open your PowerPoint presentation.
Oh,
now
okay.
It's coming.
Yeah.
Coming.
Right? Now it is.
Can you see now?
Yeah. We can see it right now.
Make it full screen.
You can make it full screen.
So, how do you make it?
Yeah, niche button, okay. Na, sir, usko press.
Is that okay?
No, is it okay now?
Can you see now?
Yeah. We can see it.
But you have to blow it in the full screen.
Now it is full screen. Okay.
Now it is full screen.
It is full screen?
Yeah.
Okay. Exactly. So I'm going to talk on interpreting coronary angiograms. Okay.
Yes.
When I talk of interpreting, I'll tell you a little about performing also. Because unless you perform, you can't interpret. Fine. So a few basic angiographic principles. You see, some things that I will talk could sound very basic or very silly. But I tell you, those silly things will also help at stage somewhere. Okay. So forgive me for that. So the first thing is you should know the anatomy and outlines of the heart chambers, because the coronaries envelop the heart in three dimensions, but are visualized on a 2D screen, that is on a flat plate. So always when we are interpreting the angiogram, we should visualize the heart behind the coronaries in the coronary angiogram. Because every vessel will run in its same heart course. So if you have an understanding of the heart in an RAO view and a heart in an LAO view, you will never falter in which artery it was and things like that. Second thing on angiogram is you must get the concept of distance. Two points which may be lying very close together in one view could be miles away in another. So, and that is what brings the concept of orthogonal viewing. It is like when I see something in line, the two shadows will fall one over the other. And when I see from the opposite side, then it becomes... My video is not coming. Can I get the video if it is okay? Then some things can be... can I do that? Can someone help me? How do I...
The camera button on your laptop, you should keep it on.
Okay.
You were seeing it before.
Can you see the picture? No. I don't know, something going wrong. Sorry.
Sir, we were seeing it right before.
Achha. Nahin, but start video.
Sharing again. You should start sharing again it.
Because it says you can't see because the host has stopped it.
Okay, something to do there.
So can the host open the video for me? Because I can't see my picture.
Okay, I'll just... Host can't stop it anyway.
Sir, if they take over,
my screen says you cannot start video because the host has stopped it.
Oh, no.
No, this is poor.
Huh?
There is a message here from the host that the internet connectivity on the speaker side is poor. Internet connectivity.
Just a sec.
Raju.
That's why they deleted the video.
Yes, there, Sagarrao.
It doesn't show the video because no, it says that the host has stopped it.
No. It is on. Actually, I told the technical people to look into it.
Start my video. Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Am I on share screen?
No, your screen is not screen. You are screen.
And the screen is coming before it's...
share screen.
Can you hear us at least? You can hear us?
Yeah, I can.
Yeah, even without the screen, you can teach some...
Is it share screen now?
Yeah, now you can see the screen.
Just come fully. I was told you were in New Zealand. When were you in New Zealand? 83, 84?
I was in New Zealand in 89
to 90. 89 to 90.
I was there. Abraham was also there in New Zealand.
80 to 82.
Abraham?
Yes.
Oh, yes. Okay. So we were in the same.
I'm listening to you. I was in radiology department for 6 months.
I know that. Okay. nice to hear from you.
In cardiac radiology.
Okay, so it is okay now. And always fine. Understand the concept of parallax, because two vessels on the same surface, like heart is a round structure. So two vessels on the same surface close together will always move together in parallel. But when they are in opposite walls, like OM and RCA, they will move in opposite directions. So by that, you can make out that these two vessels are not the same when you are seeing it on a plane. Now, just a small image there. This is the body, the heart inside. We have cranial at the top, caudal below. We have left and we have right. And then we have anterior, which will be in front. That's what I'm trying to show. And there's a posterior. So this is for the students. The X-ray tube is always posterior, that is behind. And the II is actually the eye where the image is formed. So I think this is a concept which I don't know. I'm sure people know it, but maybe if someone doesn't know it, it will help a lot. So whenever we are seeing anything, the II which is there at the top is your eye where the picture is being formed. Then you get a good concept of RAO, LAO, and the pictures that are coming. So what happens in RAO is you are seeing from the right shoulder. And so that is what is RAO. So your eye is here and you are seeing across like that. And in the LAO, you are seeing from the left shoulder. So if you have a concept of this, then a lot of things get easier for you to understand. Now, a very few basic coursing rules of vessels in RAO and LAO projections, very basic. Now, you have to understand the surface anatomy of the interventricular groove. We used to read it in anatomy. So, it is the front surface is 2/3 RV, 1/3 LV. So LAD has to run in the interventricular groove, you know that. So LAD will run on that 2/3 RV, 1/3 LV. And in a straight AP view, it will never be contour forming. As you move RAO, then it starts becoming contour forming. Otherwise, in AP type view, the vessel which is inside is LAD, diagonals are outside and septals fall perpendicular. In a LAO view, the right ventricle and the left ventricle are separate and the interventricular groove is in between. So you have the LAD falling in between and the left branches on one side on the left and the right branches on the opposite side on the right. So they are separated. Now, surface anatomy of the atrioventricular groove. Now, atrioventricular groove is the place where the RCA will run on the right side and the circumflex on the left side. Now, this atrioventricular groove in an AP or RAO view is always in profile. That is, it is a straight line. And in an LAO view, it is N-phase. When I say N-phase, means it's like a circle. You are looking inside that AV valve. So always in a LAO view, you will see the circumflex and the RCA like two circles. And in a RAO or an AP view, you will be like a straight line. And this straight line will separate the ventricles on one side from the atria on the other side. So you will never get confused. In a LAO view, you will always get confused between atrial branches, ventricular branches, because they will overlap each other. And why they overlap? Because the atria and ventricle are overlapped in a LAO view. While it is only a AP or a RAO type view where the ventricles are on one side and atria are on the other side. So always atrial branch will run on one direction and ventricular branch will run on another direction. Okay? So these are certain things which very basic one needs to understand, and then your interpretations go stronger. There is one trick now I am going to tell you, which I am sure, I'm pretty sure no one would have told you till now. In an RAO view, the PDAs and PLVs are all at the base. We know they are all horizontal and they run parallel to each other. And several times you get confused because one vessel is always moving in parallel to the other. So how do you differentiate when the heart contracts? Then the vessel that stays back at the apex is the PDA, and the vessel that moves up at the apex is the PLV. And that is how your apex beat and the apex staying the same place. Apex doesn't move up, staying the same place. And that's how you get the apex beat also. So PDA is the vessel which will stay back and PLVs will get lifted. So these are things which unfortunately, I just needed a normal angiogram to show that, but I'll see from the later examples if I get that. I didn't put it right away. So this is just a line diagram that I could get of the coronaries, and this is what I was trying to say in an AP or RAO view, an AP view specifically. You see the LAD is always inside, it is never contour forming. Diagonals will be in front and it will be inside the contour. And as you will move RAO, this LAD will start forming the contour of the heart. And in a LAO view, you see this is how it forms like a C or a circle. RCA on one part of the C and circumflex on other part of the C. Remember this picture, and then I will show you the diagram that I often make. It's not that everyone has to make that diagram, but it will make you understand this C concept. And all the ventricular branches will then fall below like that. It's like a C hanging. You see it here on the line diagram. So these are the two ventricles, which I was saying in an AP or RAO view. The ventricles are on one side. The atria will be here on the opposite side. There'll be no overlap at all. And this is the LAO view, a straight LAO view, where you see the AV valves as the circles. So the circumflex will run round like that, the RCA will run round like this. And when you make it cranial, the so-called long axis oblique view in the standard angiography things, this gets projected horizontally a little higher. So the branches will all hang from here towards the ventricle, because finally the branches have to supply the ventricle. And that is the AV valve of the left side, and that's the AV valve of the right side. Now, this is something just see this. This is a LV angiogram. There are two LV angiograms that I am showing you. Two LV angiograms. I wonder if you can make out any difference between two LV angiograms. So, and next picture will show you the difference. The first angiogram, if I stop in systole, this is it. If I stop in diastole, this is it. The second angiogram, if I stop in systole, it is on the left side below. And the second angiogram, if I stop in diastole, it is the right side below. What is the difference? I think, I don't know if anyone can make out a basic difference. A basic difference is in this diastolic frame, if you see, non-opaque blood from the atrium has entered the ventricle, so there is there is lucency in the ventricle, but there is some contrast still hanging here, and that is the LV outflow tract, because LV outflow tract and the inflow tract are basically overlapping one over the other, and the mitral valve is attached around the inflow tract on the septum side also, and the septum side has something called the atrioventricular septum, which hangs right from here, from the from between the non and right coronary artery cusp, which is the fibrous area. So you have some contrast hanging here all the time. If you will see any normal LV angiogram, you will always see this contrast hanging on these atrioventricular septum, as you see here. But this angiogram, there is no contrast hanging there. The LV outflow has been totally cleared because the atrioventricular septum is missing. And this is what is a AV canal defect. So the first angiogram was a normal angiogram, and this is a AV canal defect. I always want to show this. This is the only slide which I will show of non-coronary, so bear with me. But this is a very important thing. So to make you understand, just remember this. Okay, so that was normal, and this was AVS. Now coronary angiography. We will talk of coronary angiography. Now, coronary angiography, performing a good angiogram and its correct interpretation forms the basis of coronary intervention. I can tell you that. Don't take it as a lecture only that this is an angiographic lecture. Because this is an art which I can tell you, which is often taken for granted. Every one of us, I would say this includes our seniors also, your seniors also. We take things for granted, and not uncommonly, it is this art of performing and interpreting a good angiogram that one is lacking, and that is where the mistakes in interventions occur. So my good angiogram interpretation performance gives you the basis for intervention. Often committed mistakes in a poorly performed angiogram. I will just enlist that. Injection being done during partially hooked coronary ostia. Artery showing layering of contrast or remaining unfilled altogether. Now you see, you can only see vessels when they are fully filled with contrast. If you have not hooked the vessels well enough, then the flow will be layered, you will not fill it with contrast, and you will see lucencies which you will interpret as stenosis, and you will go wrong. Inadequate number of shoots or views taken. Specific segments, because of this round, this complex structure of the heart, segments, each segment is visualized in profile and only in specified views. So each view cannot be even taken for one full artery. This, because the artery is taking turns and taking different courses as it is traveling. So you may need different angles for different aspects, different parts of the artery. So people, several times I see two shots for the left and one for the right, and sometimes even two shots are one RAO straight, one RAO caudal, one RAO cranial, and one right. They have forgotten to do LAO. At least two views on the orthogonal plane. When I say orthogonal, means two views 90 degrees apart. Means at least one LAO, one RAO, if not anything else. So this is where mistakes occur. Other thing that happens is there are blocked contralateral vessels. You're doing a RCA, LAD is blocked. Now you want to see the LAD in the left injection because LAD is a part of left coronary. But if the LAD is blocked, you will only see it in the RCA injection. It will come through collateral flow from RCA. So when you are doing the RCA injection, unless you pan towards the LAD area in the later part of the injection and show us whether it is filling or it is not filling, how will I see that distal LAD? How will I interpret the block? And angiograms are full fraught with these mistakes that you've done the LAD, which is blocked, you've done the RC, and you've not looked for the LAD in the RC injection. You have to pan it on that direction, depending on whether it's a RAO or LAO, and you should know where the LAD is going to come in that view, and accordingly, you will pan it in that direction. Now, injection and viewing not lasting long enough so as to give time for contralateral vessels to fill. Now, the contralateral vessels, which are blocked, will take time to fill when they fill through collaterals. They will not fill straight one go. So you have to give the injection some time and wait for it to come, and then only you will be able to see it. And lastly, most of the operators, I would say 90%, invariably want to remain blind on the LV side. They are scared that the LV angio will either produce LVF or it increases the contrast load, and they don't want to do the LV. But I can tell you, every coronary angiogram, LV is very important. LV is to the coronaries what brain is to the human body. And yes, you can know it by echo, but echo several times is subjective impressions fraught with errors, and you don't have it available for review all the time. So an LV angiogram, you can always replay it again and again, and you have hard data trying to know what exactly is happening with the LV, and then you can make your decisions. So decisions on coronary blind towards the LV, well, I don't accept that. So LV to the coronaries is as brain to the human body. So one more thing. Now, we were just seeing the angiogram in the previous presentation. Seconds or 6 seconds, you get about 40 frames. And these, each frame, so it is about, so one angiogram, which is about 6 shots or 8 shots, is about 300 to 400 frames. And I tell you, you have to interpret it because it's a flowing dynamic picture. You have to see how it is, how the contrast is flowing. It has a very long bearing. So I analyze angiograms just in a fashion similar. One, it is to be angiogram interpretation frame by frame. Second is the length of the vessel. The length of the vessel also has to be interpreted inch by inch or millimeter by millimeter, as you do inching of a murmur. You are very good at inching a murmur. Why can't you inch the angiogram? You see, now I have seen the origin. I have seen the first millimeter, I've seen the second millimeter, I've seen the third millimeter. Let your brain computer analyze all these together. And sometimes the brain computer will take a little while. It cannot analyze it like a snapshot. So have that at the back of the mind, and then when you will interpret, you will be much better. So steps in coronary interpretation. Well, we need to identify the anatomy, identify all vessels in the patient, variations in the branching patterns, because there is a lot of variation in the branching patterns. There's no set one pattern, no two angiograms will always be the same. Sometimes you have a big ramus, sometimes small RCA, sometimes big circumflex. I'm not talking of dominant and non-dominant. Even in the dominant and non-dominant, there will be one, there'll be such a big ramus, and others will be teeny vessels. So you can't sort of do exactly what the syntax says, which says everything is the same. I will explain that to you. And there's always variation in course of these vessels, if any. Then the myocardial value. So because depending on the size of this vessel, and size is the anatomical area that one vessel is trying to supply, This is a concept which you will need some more time to understand. I don't think I'll be able to make you understand the whole concept of this myocardial area, but at least believe in me and understand that there is something every vessel, a big vessel has a bigger myocardial area, right? So it supplies a bigger area. So the other component of that vessel will always be small. You can't have two big ones. Like कहते एक म्यान में दो तलवार नहीं रह सकते in Hindi it's saying. So then next step is the stenosis analysis, and then comes the final recommendation. So identify the anatomy, identify each branch with its importance, then the stenosis. Because you know sometimes what happens, we count them as triple vessel disease. I'm sure people teach you that, and that is correct. But a tiny circumflex is having a stenosis and a very big ramus has come out, which is normal. I would say this is not circumflex. I will not contribute to that triple vessel and not go toward surgery. I would decide on angioplasty. So a lot of these things that I'm telling you will make you better in interventional cardiology, in angioplasty also. Because everyone soon wants to do angioplasty, I know that. So what is the more important information in an angiogram? Think about it. If it is a surgical case, like we said the previous case was surgical, 36 syntax and triple vessel disease, you see what is more important for the surgeon, it is the number of vessels, branches or divisions that are independently diseased that he needs to put grafts on, the quality of the distal vessels. The detailed number and type of stenosis is not as crucial for him. And the LV, how is the left ventricle? These are the four things that he needs. And we give him everything other than, except for the stenosis, which he's not so interested. Do we describe quality of distal vessel in our angiographic reports? I don't think it is there. Does our angiographic report has concepts of how big each vessel is, how many vessels really, the independent stems need grafts. Do we do LV? We don't do it 90% of the times. And this is what we do. And what is needed for angioplasty? If the patient is for angioplasty, what is needed? Here, it is the proximal course, the anatomy and branching pattern, which is very important. If you can replicate and understand what is the proximal course, anatomy, each division, because that is where you have to cross the wire. Exact location and type of each stenosis is important here, not to the surgeon. As long as the surgeon knows that this is severe vessel or it's occluded vessel and distal vessel is good and you need to put a graft. That's more than enough for the surgeon. But yes, for us, there is a 90 followed by 80 followed by another 60 and then there is a long gap and something else is happening. So an exact location and the type of each stenosis has to be known. This is a stenosis with a thrombus, this is a stenosis with a calcium, this is a stenosis which is eccentric, because we need to deal with them. And of course, it is good to know the distal vessel even for us, because unless the distal vessel is good, we can't get flows down, and LV is equally important for us. So this is where I differ in with people's thoughts on how to report on angiograms. Now, pitfalls in coronary reporting. Now, what happens in our, we usually follow the ACC, American College of Cardiology, pictures which are there, which are floating everywhere. That's okay. But each individual coronary anatomy is somewhat different. You must know that. And pre-drawn diagrams, as the American College of Cardiology with the proximal stems made and distal left for you to complete or something like that. Well, that can be done. But freehand diagrams, people also make, but they are not reproducible and you cannot teach on them. And most of these reporting systems, I tell you, including the syntax, does not tell you the myocardial value based on the anatomical size of the vessel. For him, all OMs are same. Once there is an OM, you add 0.5, 0.5, 0.5. Whether that OM is three times of another OM, that is a problem, and they go by name of the vessel rather than by the size of the vessel. So that is these are some issues. Ideally, what should be there is you should identify all independent stems with significant stenosis rather than trying to count 1, 2, 3 vessels like that. The branching patterns and course and size of vessels of each stem to be known very specifically in a case for PCI, as I told you. Myocardial value is important. Then you need to do the stenosis analysis. Then you can do a score calculation, and then you can make a final calculation. Now, this I will just run through. This, incidentally, Dr. Abraham is also sitting there. He was also trained the same way. So now this is the 1977 publication of the Green Lane Hospital, where this is, I think, the only published way of reporting on the angiograms, okay, by Dr. Brandt. And then this was done in those era when angioplasty was non-existent. Then I modified some things there and wrote my perspective on relooking onto the reporting of the angiograms in the interventional era. Tried to make the same thing, but slightly modified. So what is this now? This is the picture of the heart. I showed you the real picture of the heart before, and I told you, remember it, I will come back again. So A, this is the apex of the heart in the center. The two circles, the left ventricle circle you can see as a circle D, the right ventricle is like a triangle. So this is the other part of the circle. This is actually a LAO view if you see. The septum is hanging in between. The left ventricle is on the left. The right side ventricle is on the right. You have the apex here, and the three dimensions have been compressed like that, one over the other. So you have the AV groove here on the circle, and the apex is here, and the entire ventricular surface runs from the AV groove to the apex. AV groove to the apex. AV groove to the apex. So here you will have the diagonals running. So LAD will run here. PDA will run here. We have the diagonals running in this way. The OM's running like that. The PLV is running like this. Whether they come from RCA, you can draw it from the RCA. If they come from circumflex, you can draw it from the circumflex. And you will never overdo anything. You will not overshoot. So if one is big, the other one will automatically become small. So, and that is what the reality is in true life. So where are the coronaries? So you can put the coronaries in. So the LAD comes here, the diagonals come here, the OMs come here. Now this is the dominant RCA. It has a PDA, PLV, multiple branches, everything comes. And you can do that. And then the coronaries, once inserted, you can do the stenosis, and every branch is from the place where it is arising, so you can be very exact. You can really know. In fact, I don't even have to see an angiogram if my diagram is there before I do angioplasty. Okay? And because I know exactly where it is blocked, how long it is blocked. Because this is the real heart. This is the real heart. And the stenosis have been inserted. So, and then anatomy is changed. Now, you see, this is like a super dominant RCA, which you understand it is coming huge branches all the way till the OM territory, and circumflex is a teeny, teeny vessel. So why should I call this triple vessel disease? Yeah, I can do angioplasty of the diagonal and the RCA first and then the diagonal, and everything is over. Otherwise, someone will say, oh, circumflex blocked, diagonal disease, big vessel, LAD system, and RCA 100. Oh. So it helps us in interventions also a lot. That's our diagram. We can. So, well, this I don't think I will try to explain to you the limitations and fallacies of syntax, which our system improves on it. We keep it aside for the present. I explained you certain. That's what I published also of late, the fallacies in the syntax. Okay. Now we will go to the standard coronary angiographic views. I told you that because of these curvilinear courses of the vessels, like, you know, think of the left coronary. The left coronary arises from the left sinus. It is behind, in between the pulmonary artery and the aorta. It runs horizontally away from the left sinus, and then it moves forward and then comes inside and then towards the interventricular groove. So there is a curvilinear course. So every segment of the vessel is going to be profiled in a different view. Now, this is something I would say is difficult to remember right away. You can note it down, you whatever you do, mug it up. But this is 105% correct. When I say 105, I know what I'm saying. So left main or eleocranial view. The first view I always advocate is eleocranial view. Why? Because eleocranial view is the one which will tell you, show you the left main ostium. Okay. You might have been taught that it is the eleocaudal view that shows it. I will explain you in between somewhere. The caudal views may not be able to get it. It will depend on the orientation of the vessel. Largely, it is a horizontal heart or a vertical heart. And in them, it is eleocranial. It is only if the heart is very horizontal or going up, then a caudal view could show it. But otherwise, usually it's the regular heart that it is. Left main ostium will be seen in the eleocranial view. You can see the LAD diagonal divisions well, but you can't see the LAD circumflex. There will be an overlap. Then you can see the distal circumflex, but not the proximal LAD circumflex division, as I told you, and then distal RCA. So things like that. Then you have an RAO view where you see the left main and the LAD circumflex overview. RAO caudal shows the division between the LAD and circumflex very well, and so does the AP caudal, and including the left main bifurcation. A straight LAO view is best for circumflex. If you want to give a final interpretation of a circumflex lesion, it is the LAO 60 degrees view and nothing else. Well, if you don't do a LAO view thinking that you'll get more radiation, I can't help it. But that is the view. You will not get that circumflex stenosis in any other view. Lateral is for mid and distal LAD. Sometimes you need that. And then areocranial for the entire length of LAD. And the distal OMs. The distal OMs are beautifully seen in areocranial, except their origins. Okay. Now, there are some optional views for left coronary, like the AP caudal. If it is, as I told you, there's a usual or a inferiorly going heart, then standard. But when there is a superiorly going heart, then sometimes it is LAO caudal in place of straight LAO, which shows the bifurcation well. And then maybe you might see the left main also here. And this is what is the standard spider view that everyone is very fancy about. Do a spider view, spider view. Correct. But I take it as an optional view. When the heart is horizontal, that is the only time. Otherwise, a straight LAO view is equally good. And for left main ostium, it is the eleocranial view. I'll show you some examples where, if I have time, where these things may be seen. For the RCA, you do standard LAO and RAO view. And then there are some optional views like eleocranial, steep RAO, for divisions. I think most of the people must have talked to that, so that's okay. So this is the picture which shows that. That's a standard LAO view, and then a cranial LAO view which separates these PDAPLVs much better. And then you have the RAO standard view. This is where all these vessels overlap each other, and then when the heart contracts, one of them will stay back at the apex. This is the apex, the tip of the vessel. And the others will move up as the heart contracts. And the one that stays back at the apex is the PDA, and others are the PLVs. And that's the areocranial view, which makes each of these vessels rise up and up, and you see them better. Now, how to get coaxial with RCA? Like, you hook the RCA usually with a JR catheter like that. Well, looks okay. But when you see in RAO, it is going like that in front. So you have to rotate it clockwise slightly, and then you will become coaxial, and then you will be totally in the vessel. But make sure that you don't get too deep in that, okay? So, and when rotating catheters, understand that it takes time for the torques to get transmitted to catheter tips. Wait for the response to occur. It's not that you keep rotating on this side and then finally it reaches the right place and then jumps out. So, rotate, wait, see that rotation is transmitted to the to the tip of the catheter and the action has happened, and then you will realize. A little word about graft angiography. Well, always in a patient post CABG, you do the native vessels first. And you must understand the paradox of the amount of filling through the native injection. What is that paradox? More the filling in the native injection, less the flow from the grafts. That means the grafts are blocked. And if I do a native injection and I find everything is blocked, that is LAD 100, LAD 100, circumflex 100, that means this patient is having a good graft. So it is just the opposite. And two injections each in LCA and RCA are good enough in two orthogonal views, because it is the grafts that you are more interested in aligning for the distal vessels. So one RAO, one LAO is more than enough. And then 90% times the SVGs are hooked with a JR catheter. Well, there used to be bypass graft catheters. They are there, but I don't think I have used them much ever. The JR catheter does the job usually. And the hooking views for the right grafts, it is a shallow LAO view that will profile the right graft. And for the left grafts, it is a shallow RAO view that will profile the left graft in the origin of the left graft. Because when I say profile, means it is in silhouette with the border of the aorta. Okay? So there is a border of, because if it is inside the border of the aorta, you will not be able to hook it. You will not be able to profile it. So if it is on the border, then you know when I'm running my catheter along the border of the aorta, if the view is such that the graft is profiled in that, it will go in there. Okay. And Lima, you should select the subclavian in a LAO view because the arch is open in that, you know that. Then exchange for a Lima catheter and then pull back in RAO, because that is the view RAO where this subclavian first, second parts are longer. In LAO, they get foreshortened one over the other. So you move a lot of distance, you don't know that you've already moved so much. So it is in the RAO. And then it profiles the origin of the Lima also in the RAO. This is what I was trying to show you, that you see this is a shallow LAO view, standard 50-60 degrees. Even here the RCA graft is not profiled, but when you make it shallow to about 30 degrees, then you see it in profile. This is the RCA graft. And when you go to the left graft, when you see the shallow LAO view, you see these are the left veins, venous grafts with that. So you don't need actually the surgeon's reports. By understanding the anatomy, by knowing which vessels you have seen in the native injection, which vessels you have seen in the graft injection, you know your viewing is complete or incomplete. You get it. So you really don't need that how many grafts are there, the surgeon has written it, and things like that. Well, it is there, it's good, but you can do it even otherwise. And that's the Lima being shown. So that's the left subclavian, and the Lima is profiled in RAO. Okay. Small tips and technique. This is for the radial people who want to do radial procedures, ensure a painless procedure. Invariably, problems of spasm, this, that, everything that happens is because of pain. So good local anesthetic by an intradermal wheel should be there. Try to do a single wall puncture as far as possible. And pain is the commonest cause for spasm. And always while doing angiograms, anticipate a problem and act rather than taking it back once the problem occurs. You know, like you're doing an angiogram, suspect a vasovagal at the first evidence of a fall in heart rate. Your heart rate was going 80, you see there is something going on, patient is not well, and your heart rate is 68. He's going to go for a vasovagal. Pressure right now is okay, but soon will fall. So something like that, so you can immediately take action. Handling catheter damping, rotation in the right direction is more important than pullback. As I told you, for the right coronary, you are doing clockwise and then trying to get more coaxial. So. But when you are getting more coaxial, you are also getting deeper. So if the catheter is deep and you want to get it back, undo that action, make it anti-clock, you will try to get back. If you pull it, immediately the whole thing will come out. So just do an action opposite of selective hooking. Like L&D sometimes is hooked by anti-clock and advance. So if you getting deeper in the LED, you make it clock and pull. So you do the action opposite, it will help. Things like that. Now, some important differentiations. You often mix this. LED from diagonal in RAO, I told you that the LEDs will always be a little inside and diagonal outside. A blocked diagonal. Blocked vessels keep coming up. So now, block diagonal or is the block OM from RV branches of RCA and RAO. So they are overlapping each other. PDA from PLV in RAO, I've talked about that. So the block diagonal versus RV branch, you can make out by their moving in opposite directions. You look for orthogonal view or a parallax in the same view, you will be still able to detect. Now I'll show you this example. Now you see there is a vessel that is filling through collaterals. This is a left injection. There's a vessel that is filling through collaterals in this first injection. What is it? Is it Ramus? Is it OM? Is it RCA? Now this is shown here in the opposite view, orthogonal view. You see that vessel is right on the opposite side. It is here. It is RCA. And I am sure people think that this is a Ramus or a OM and this OM is blocked here. It is just reaching there. No. You see it is moving opposite to the vessel very close. This is the diagonal. So if it were an OM type of vessel or a diagonal type vessel, it would move almost parallel to this. But it is moving opposite to itself that this is RCA. But if you can, if you want to confirm it and you do orthogonal view and you will see the RCA is now totally on the right. And so the vessel that is filling through collaterals is on the right. It's RCA, it is not RIM. The story of missing vessels. Several times you say, well, LED is not seen, LED is blocked. Well, correct, a missing vessel could be 100% blocked. But I can assure you every 100% vessel usually is seen filling through collaterals and you are expected to show it. Because unless you see that vessel, the surgeon cannot put a graft. Unless you show that vessel, the angioplaster cannot do a CTO angioplasty. Acute occlusion sometimes may show no filling. So unless it is a real acute occlusion. And several times, even in acute occlusions, you will be able to see. And the other is, maybe you have not filled the vessel at all. Why? Because it is an anomalous origin. What is anomalous origin? Like right arising from the left sinus, left arising from the right sinus. So maybe it's anomalous origin, or it is not truly anomalous, but just that it is separate origin. Like it's a double orifice left main. So what you have hooked is the circumflex and the LED is very close by and you have not hooked it and you feel that it is blocked. So these things you can make a mistake and you must not do that. And this, a vessel truly remaining blocked, it is only very rare and only when it is a true dead calcified scar territory and the vessel is also gone. Other than that, you will always be able to see a vessel. Okay. So I think more often than not, as I told you, by anatomy itself, you can make out, you will get a void in the myocardial territory supply if you understand that whole supply area of the heart. And that actually helps us in not losing on these missing vessels. Now, this is a publication again from Green Lane. This is a very good publication. I want to show this to you because this is something where students are shown cases and they always falter. You must note this down and read this. It's anomalous origin from the opposite side, okay, of a vessel. How does it come? Now, this is it. This is a normal left coronary in RAO view and LAO view. We always believe in two views, orthogonal, okay? Now, if the left coronary instead of the left sinus is coming from the right sinus, it has to finally go to the left. Then only it will supply. How will it go? It has four ways to go. It can either go behind the aorta like that, or it can go in between the two arteries, or it can go in front of the pulmonary artery, looping in front of the pulmonary artery, or it can take a septal course from the right sinus, septum, and then reach the anterior interventricular tube. How all this we are understanding? Because we are keeping the heart behind the coronaries. I never see the coronaries alone. I always see the heart behind the coronary. So that is how it will go. Now, this is something which you need to, this is a beautiful paper, I can tell you. And no lateral views, the prachalan hai, there is some publication of lateral views also with the aortic catheter inside, and then you can make out. But I tell you, this is the best. So you decide when it goes from the right to left, or it will come from left to right, the RCA. Similarly, it will either take a loop which will be caudal, niche, or cranial, anterior or posterior, right? So it has been divided into that. So loop is anterior and cranial, then it is RV free ball, because you see it's a move in front and upper, top. Then only it will cross the in front of the RVOT, come back into the interventricular groove and come down. Okay. If it is a septal course, again it has to move in front only. So the loop is anterior, but it is caudal. It has to go down into the septum and then reach here. If it is an interarterial course, if it's a retroaortic course, this is easier to understand. I'll show you this first. It will always go caudal, it will go down, and then behind the aorta, so behind posterior, so caudal posterior loop. And if it is interarterial, the loop is slightly posterior but cranial, and then going down in between the two arteries. And I invariably find when I show these angios to people, the real angios, they'll invariably sit in between the two arteries. No, there are four courses, so think about it. This is in congenital heart disease, the courses of coronaries and different. I think I will skip this, otherwise I'll take too much. Okay, now this is a technique which has been described by me in 2000, early 2000 or somewhere, right? This is when you have dextrocardia, dextrocardia with normal coronaries, there's no problem, mirror image branching, mirror image. But what if a patient has dextrocardia and coronary artery disease? You have a single beautiful lesion, still no problem. You have coronary artery disease like the patient whom you presented just before, triple vessel, one is blocked, one is not seen, something like that. Now, what will happen? You can't interpret that angiogram. You'll get pictures like this. Can you interpret this? What is happening in this angiogram? This is dextrocardia with coronary artery disease. At least I can't make out what is happening. But I have done something in that picture. I can now make out. This is a LAO cranial view. This is a RAO type view, and this is the LAD in front, and this is the blocked RCA. Everything I can make out. What have I done? I have done the double inversion technique. And what is this? This technique, every cath lab machine has a horizontal sweeps reverse. That means you can make right look left, left look right. So you have to do that. That is one inversion. But there is a second inversion, and that is very specific. You want to see the vessel as it looks in a LAO cranial view. So keep the cranial as it is. If you want to see LAO 50, cranial 20, keep the cranial as it is. But instead of LAO 50, make it RAO 50. You want to see it in a RAO caudal view, in RAO 40, caudal 15. Instead of RAO 40, make it LAO 40. Let the caudal remain the same and the horizontal sweep reverse. And then you will get pictures like this. Okay? So this is LAO cranial view standard. this is a REO type view. I have done just a double inversion. Okay. So, and so this is a straight LAO view. This is a lateral view, something like that with double inversion. Okay. So everything looks good. This is a RCA, looks good. So something like that. So this is, you can read about it. And this is very standard types of lesions. Everyone has described that. I don't think I need to talk about it. Now, lesion assessment, I'm just talking of the mistakes that people do. Always interpret in completely filled vessels, as I told you right in the beginning. If the angiogram is not good, you can't interpret it. You say, sorry, sir, I can't do it because it is not hooked. If the artery is not hooked, how do you want me to interpret? Second thing is, there should be no overlap or crossing vessels. You should get a frame or a view where overlap is not there, because the point where two arteries overlap, there is always something called a MAC effect. And the MAC effect is that the denser looks more dense and the lighter looks more light. So if you have a vessel diagonal crossing a OM and the lesion is at that crossing point, at the crossing point, that lesion will start looking even more severe and you will mistake it. So if you do all these things, I can tell you, we don't even need FFR. I can, if you're good at angiographic interpretation, I can assure you of that. And that's what the right view and the right frame, if you have, then because eye sees what the brain knows. So you have to get the right view and the right frame. In a single run, examine each vessel along its length. This is about the inching I was telling you. Because sometimes what happens, it is like the oculostenotic reflex. We understand the oculostenotic reflex. What is it? A discrete lesion will always look more severe. A moderate lesion along a length will not look as severe, but if you do FFR, you will find it more severe than that discrete lesion. Why? Because you have not inched the vessel. Your eye is focused on that discrete lesion. So always inch the vessel. Inch means step by step, every part of the vessel. Is it normal? Is it, throw this question in air. Is it normal? Is it disease? Is it normal? Is it disease? Is it normal? Is it disease? And then you will, your brain computer will tell you how much is this. Identify reference vessel size, not by what is the segment adjacent to it, but what should it be? You've seen the normal left main of that patient. You've seen some part of a normal artery of that patient. Make an assessment. What should be the normal be here? And then assess the stenosis. Not because you know atherosclerosis is a diffuse disease. It will be there all through the artery. Concentrate on the width of the flow present at the stenosis site, working on our half full rather than half empty. If you will try to see the jar half empty, you will overdiagnose. But when you will try to see the jar half full, you will always be able to interpret it more correct. And moderate long lesions are often ischemia producing and are underrated and left by several people. So I think if you do correct eyeballing, you can always make things correct, even in the angiographic interpretation. That is what I am trying to say. I think we will skip this. You would probably know that, you know, when the artery is 70% diameter stenosis, it is already 90% area loss. 50% stenosis is 75%. So you must have this concept of diameter versus area loss, because what happens is till about 50% diameter loss, there is no reduction in flow. From 50 to 70% diameter loss, some reduction of flow on exercise will come down, but rest symptoms will usually not happen. So if there is a patient who's having rest symptoms and stenosis is 60% by diameter, I don't think that is the culprit lesion. So it will help you in understanding culprit lesions when you will do intervention. We'll skip this. Now, just the end of my talk, I'll show you some examples. And if there is time is enough, you can tell me, I can stop that. No problem. This is what I wanted to show. the left main ostium. Now you see this. Now these are two angiograms. One is AP caudal view, another is LA caudal view. But I think everything, I don't know, we don't have time to interact. Everything looks pretty normal. But now you see the iliocranial view from the same patient. Now you see I've pulled back the catheter here to show you how the Silhart sign is seen. You see the boundary of the aorta, the boundary of the artery arising, and how beautifully you see that there is at least 60 to 70% stenosis of the left main here, which you could never see on a RAO and an AP caudal or LAO caudal. So that's what I wanted to tell you. Now, this is moderate disease in the OM. You see this? You say it's moderate. This is the RAO view. I taught you that this is AP caudal view. Okay. Hardly looks like a disease, I would say. Nothing. Now, this is a LAO view from the same patient. Now, you see it here in that frame that I have stopped. It is very severe. Okay. You can see it in motion also here. Then I have selected a frame because each frame I am running and I'm trying to see where what is coming. And now you see it is severe because this part got foreshortened in the RAO type view. And that's what I was trying to say, always see. What is the significance of this LAD disease? Now see this here. Okay, sorry, previous. I showed it in my presentations in the class here and people said it's moderate, well, nothing. And you see, it is significant. FFR is 0.74. Why? Because this is long moderate and we had to do intervention on that. Okay. Now, the other thing is we very easily say that RCA has two occlusions. Now, this is it. RCA blocked here at the top, CTO also below, two occlusions, sir. But now see the collateral filling. Now this collateral filling is filling it all the way up till this part, and this part has to and fro flow. Can you see that? Now these are things that are difficult to show, but you need to know it and see it more and more for yourself. And this to and fro flow tells me that it is patent there and it's only one block and I can do the CTO. And I just opened at one place and the entire vessel was open. There is some disease down below, but the entire vessel is open. So I think with this now injection type, now you see, this is a cursory diagnostic injection made by someone outside with us only, were done by my resident. And you see, seeing this, I said, oh, well, everything is blocked. I don't know what to do. Then I saw it from close distance, and this was the angiogram done by me with the guiding catheter. Now you see, I have flow both in the LAD and the circumflex, antegrade flow. It is just a better injection, that's all. So, because you have to fill the entire chamber, the principle of injection is the entire chamber transiently has to fill with contrast. So you have to give as much dye as that chamber can carry. It is so for a left injection, you need to give at least 5 to 6, 7 mL sometimes. And especially if the flow is slow, you need to have it longer so that you give it time for the flow to happen. And then it is patent. And then I can do angioplasty, no problem. Okay. This is another RCA CTO. This was done in a live case. Someone, the operator from outside said, oh, very difficult, very long CTO, because distally you see only this much part and here it is this much, very long CTO, I don't know. And then I said, let me do the angiogram. And so where is the catch? Here itself, you see some little flow coming, which is difficult to show here. You can only see it from a close distance on the monitor. And then you see this. This is the same patient, same, nothing has changed. Just my hand of injection. Now this is guiding catheter RV branch, right? So, and then it is complete. I think with this, we will call it a day. I'll skip the other examples. I've talked of all this. and we will, because these are some CTO examples that I had kept. Maybe this will be for some senior audience. And I think with this, I will conclude my talk. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Goyal, for your...
I will just conclude it.
Yeah.
Seeing and imagining the heart behind the coronaries forms the basis of understanding the coronary anatomy. Okay. Two, understanding the coronary anatomy forms the basis of performing a good angiogram. And performing a good angiogram forms the basis of correct interpretation. And visualizing each angiographic run as a collection of images and not as one snapshot picture forms the foundation for interpreting flow patterns and stenosis severity. And orthogonal viewing, which is 90 degrees apart, forms the fundamental for knowing or understanding reality. And it is the skills of good angiographic performance and correct interpretation that's coronary intervention, because you see what you know. Best interventionist needs the cardiologist's mind and the radiologist's eye. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Goyal, for your extensive and elaborate presentation regarding interpretation of coronary angiogram. We still have about 5 minutes for any of the students to ask the questions.
If there are any questions, that I can address.
Sure.
Thank you, Dr. Goyal. Can I, for the excellent talk, as usual. One thing is, even the cardiologist can have good eyes. Not the radiologist alone.
No, I said it is the radiologist's eye. Radiologist apostrophe S. Because radiologist does everything.
Radiologist does everything physician brain based. Well, lighter when I told that. But one point I think you should also highlight, which you keep telling, is if you have a lesion eccentric, which has a mild type of disease in one view and a tight lesion in the other view, that point you didn't stress. So you tell us.
I didn't.
Please explain that. Yeah, please explain that to people.
Yeah, you see what happens is, if there is eccentric lesion, so again, it is like a shadow forming. What we see images are shadows. So eccentric lesion, so if I am seeing it N phase, the lumen, N phase, I will see a broad lumen, right? So I will get a very small stenosis. When I will see it in profile, then I will see a, I will see a severe stenosis. But when I will see eccentrically, I will see a broad lumen flowing, it will be opposite. But what happens is in this, what I say, there will be, if we had video densitometry along with it, you see a broad lumen, but density-wise, it will be less because there will be less pixels of contrast inside because it is not taking the full depth of the vessel, but only a very small depth of the vessel because it is eccentric. So these eccentric lesions are often misdiagnosed, for which we have IVUS and things which show it better. But if you keep the concept of video densitometry, which you can, that this lesion is looking broad, but it is very faint here. Why is it so faint? Because the depth of contrast that it is carrying is less. So that is how eccentrics can be assessed. Yeah, does it address it, Srinivas?
Yeah, looks hazy. That means it looks hazy in one view. That because of less.
Yes, it is. It is the density.
Yeah,
density is less.
Yes. Okay.
That is what happens actually. That is what happens in reality.
Okay, thank you.
And
you know, still drawing those diagrams in your institution, yes, Dr. Brand diagrams?
Yes, sir. I am still drawing them. I have changed from area loss to diameter loss. Because what used to happen was the original Brand system is area loss. So area loss means I used to write 90. And then that diagram went to someone else's hand and he said, had an 80% lesion and you did not intervene. I said diameter wise, it is only 60 or 70. That's why I did not
realize. Yeah.
Oh, but who's going to explain everyone? So then I changed it to diameter. And in the other paper that I wrote, I talked about diameter loss.
So are you keeping that 15 myocardial score?
Yes, this Dr. Abraham, based on that diagram, now very soon I will get a computerized software that Univas will say does not come. But it has a score which is based on that 15 myocardial value instead of 6 of syntax. I showed you some slides which I did not expand upon the limitations of syntax. I hope you will understand that. So no, I have taken care of those limitations and sort of made the Greenland diagram computerized and made all permutation combinations. And I think this score, I will analyze the score relation to syntax. The system is almost ready. Srinivas, bear with me. And I will try to make it publishable or commercial.
No, that will be great. Because otherwise it's a little labor intensive. You know, to draw the diagram.
It is little labor intensive, but the system that I have made it asks you a few questions, just like the syntax asks you a few questions, and then you are able to answer it, and then you enter the things, and it takes care of bifurcations. A lot of things are there in that.
I have amalgamated
the current interventional cardiology with the Greenland system of interpretation, which was only diagram, and got that both computerized. And now that you are here, I will try to send it to you. I am on the process for that. It is almost
Thank you, Dr. Goyal. Thank you, Dr. Goyal, for your time and expertise and the time you have spent in explaining the interpretation of coronary angiogram. The next session will be